Are you there, Dr. Johnson?
Yes.
Okay, when you're ready.
Pete takes to all the sweet name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. What a great blessing it is to worship the Lord on his day. Praise the Lord for all his mercies, all his providence, all his guidance, the protection and care that is extended to the past. My heartfelt Sabbath greetings and blessings to each one of you, the Manchester North Seventh-day Adventist Church and all the congregation. I thank you all for the God-given opportunity to be a part of your worship this Sabbath. My thanks go to your pastor, Ebenezer Daniel, for giving me the opportunity to share the word of God with you all. I am sure in a time of trouble, and when we are all engrossed with various difficulties and worries, God leads us the way he wants us to walk. I pray that God's richest blessings be showered upon each one of you as you're worshiping together the mighty Lord, the Creator, on his Sabbath day. I want to thank the church elder, Tyler, for the kind words to introduce me to the congregation. Thank you, elders, once again.
Amen.
In our state, in our country, an old story is being told about a washerman and his dog and his donkey. So nowadays we are living in a modern world that things are all being changed. In our traditional Indian way of living, each village they have us a washerman, and his family used to do the washing of the clothes for all the people there. And this washerman is to carry the clothes to the riverbed using a donkey or maybe donkeys. And in such one washerman's family, there was a donkey, and also the washerman had a pet dog with him. The donkey used to be brought to the washerman's house early in the morning, and the washerman normally keeps the very big baggage of clothes to be washed at the back of the donkey, and he used to send it to the riverside. Along with the washerman, the donkey used to carry the heavy bundle of clothes. Then once the donkey and the washerman reaches the riverbed, and the bundle is being brought down, and the donkey is chased. It is to go out and graze for food. The evenings, once the work is done, again the washerman gets the donkey back, and the donkey has to carry the bundle back home. After the work is done, again the donkey has to go around and look for his food. Nobody bothers till the next morning. But his pet dog was always with the washerman. It had no work to do. The washerman used to feed the dog very carefully, morning and evening, maybe milk, rice, egg, and etc. And at times, the dog used to play with the washerman. He loved playing with the pet dog. And the donkey used to look at this washerman and the pet dog. See, I am working very hard. This fellow is not providing me any food. Every morning and evening, I'm carrying heavy load of bundles of cloth. But he is not doing anything to me. I have to find my own food. But this dog always plays with him, but he cares for it. It was a grievance that was found in the donkey. One evening, this washerman and his wife had a quarrel, and this man was very much upset and angry, and he was sitting in front of the house with upset mood. And now the dog as usual, he wanted to play with the master. So the dog went and jumped over him. The washerman was very much upset. So he kicked the pet dog and it fell down far away, screaming, it ran off. And it was a bit injured. The donkey was very much happy on seeing this. And the dog was very much upset. Every day, every moment, I used to keep my master very happy. But today he has really done injustice to me. So tonight, I am not going to do my responsibility. There is God in the house. So the night came off. Everybody went to bed. It was the midnight. A thief stealthily entered into the premise of the washerman's house. So when the dog saw this man, the thief coming inside, now it reminded of the evening's incident. And it decided once again, I am not going to bark. I am not going to chase the thief. And I am going to be calm and quiet. Let the things be robbed or stolen away from the house. The donkey was watching all over this. So once again, it tried to recollect what all it used to think. See, what an ungrateful dog it is. How much care the master is giving to the dog. How much sweet and nice food he is feeding the dog. But the dog is ungrateful to disperse his responsibility this evening, this night. So the donkey decided somehow it should protect and safeguard the master's property. It looked at the dog was quiet lying down. So the donkey began to bray. It made a very big noise. So when the donkey was making very big noise, the washerman opened the door and came out. So immediately this thief ran away. So when he ran away, this man could not find anybody there. And donkey also became silent. So the man, he entered the house and began to sleep. After a while, again the thief came to rob all the things. So again the dog was silent. So the donkey began to make a big noise, started to bray. So now the washerman was really upset. Already he was angry and upset with his wife. So this man came out. What is wrong with you today? Why are you making big noise? I'm not able to sleep. So he took a rod and beat on the donkey heavily. So it began to yell and cry and it ran off. And after a while, again, the man went inside and he began to sleep. The robber came. The donkey was not there. The dog was silent and the thief was able to steal everything that was found there and he went away. The next morning, when the washerman opened the door to see the clothes, what he used to keep as a very important, because that all the belongings of the people of the village, nothing was found there. So he was very much upset. The story goes on like this. So now here comes the important role and the goal of the donkey. The donkey's goal in the absence of the responsibility or the ungratefulness of the dog was to save the master's property. It was a very good and appreciable goal. It wanted to safeguard the master's property. But at the same time, the role of the donkey as it is being meant or being prescribed is not to safeguard the master's property. The role of the donkey is very much stipulated to be an animal of burden, to carry the bundle or baggages. That's all. So now, even though the goal was appreciable, the role of the donkey is being misunderstood and the donkey was punished for that. So goal and the role are something very important in our lives. We set our goals sometimes. Sometimes somebody else set our goals. But all of us, God has set is our goals to complete. But even though God sets a goal for us, or if somebody else set the goal for us, or even I myself set the goal for me, the very important role to reach the goal is destined or it's assigned on me only. So the assignment of the goal may be from anybody. maybe my own goal, or maybe from my family or my church or the society, or maybe from God. But the role is something very, very important, because it is fully on my shoulders. So how far, as we are living in this world, spiritually and worldly, we are clear about our goals and roles. They call it a goal clarity and the role clarity. Now, we are all people who are given the privilege to read the word of God deeply. We dwell deep into the truth to know what is given by God for our life and the life to come. As a preacher and a teacher, maybe as a pastor, as an educationist, I have been to a number of churches and have raised only one single question many times. And why are we here on the Sabbath day? Why are we here on the Sabbath day? So to keep the Sabbath, why are we here on the Sabbath day was the only question I asked in a number of churches, and many people have given different definitions or different answers to the question. And people say, we are here to keep the Sabbath or observe the Sabbath. We are here because God has created the world, and he has created the seventh day, and he made it holy for us to keep it holy. And few people say, the commandment says, Sabbath is to be observed holy. And theologians say, the Sabbath is a sign of God's creation. It is a covenant between you and me, that is God and myself. A few youngsters say, we are here to have fellowship with my friends and fellow believers. And few people say, I am taught and I am used to attend the church on Saturday since my childhood, so I am here. And few deacons, Sabbath school sponsors, or the superintendents or the elders, they say, I am here to conduct the church services. And all these, or maybe a few more answers, are given by various people. Now, due to what of time, I just want to limit it. And are they the goals of our spiritual life? Observing Sabbath, keeping the commandments, to learn more about God, to follow God's instruction, to conduct church services, to have fellowship. And it's a routine practice I am used to and I'm taught to follow the or to attend the church on Saturday. And these are something very interesting. Are they roles or goals? If each one of us are given with a goal clarity and role clarity, we will be able to distinctly differentiate them and to know what is our goal and what is our role in our spiritual living. The role clarity and the goal clarity is something very, very interesting, and it is very, very important, and it's very, very significant in our day-to-day life. Unless until I have a goal, I cannot play a role. Unless until I have a role to play, I cannot reach the goal. So I need to be very much clear about this. The goal clarity and the role clarity, they always go hand in hand. From the Bible, there are a number of illustrations, a number of beautiful characters who teaches the close relationship or the bondage between the goal clarity and the role clarity. How much important they are, how it decides our destiny, or how we play our role on the goal, or how we play a role without goal, and all these are very beautifully given in the scriptures for us to learn. So prayerfully, let's wait and see how we are able to have the goal clarity and the role clarity. If it is God's will, let's have a clear, transparent mind to accept the reality that we will have a self-examination to have a goal clarity and the role clarity. In the Matthew 19 chapter, verses from 16 to 22, A beautiful incident is being recorded. Here comes a young man to Lord Jesus Christ. And he calls Jesus as a good teacher. And he put forth an interesting question. A teacher, what good things must I do to get eternal life? Now this man is aware of a goal. He has set a goal. And he wants to confirm, or he wanted to know more about the roles that he has to play to reach the goal. That is, he has a goal clarity and he wants to have little more role clarity. So he asked Jesus Christ, "Dear Lord, my teacher, what good things, what is supposed to be my role clarity that I get eternal life?" Now Jesus Christ simply said, "You obey the commandments." As we people say, we Seventh Day Adventists obey the commandments. We are the only church who uphold the Ten Commandments. We say the God's commandments are shown to us to be followed. So this man says, "Yes, my teacher, I have been obeying the commandments since my childhood." Now, if anybody asks me, I'll also say, because I am born and brought up in Seventh Day Church and educated in the Seventh Institution and served the Lord for more than 40 years. I am 68 years now, and I can say I have been obeying the commandments, but do I? But this man, he is speaking to Lord Jesus, who is able to read the inner minds of the people, so he cannot tell a lie. And he said, "Yes, teacher, I obey the commandments since my childhood. All these I have kept. What do I still lack?" Now he wants to have a little more role clarity, because his goal clarity is very much vivid. He was very much clear about the definite about the goal clarity. "I need to enter into eternal life." So to himself, he feels the role clarity is not that good enough for him to fulfill. So he asks repeatedly, "Yes, what do I lack?" Now Jesus said, "To be perfect, go sell all your possessions and give to the poor, then come and follow me." Now we know the story. This man never turned up. So goal clarity may be known to each one of us. All of us, maybe in our walk of life, we have a goal clarity, except for a few cases. But when it comes to role clarity, most of us are not able to fulfill or to have 100% role clarity. So this man, when the role clarity was given with a detailed picture, the panoramic view, and he is not able to accept it. So now the role clarity is like a mirror. Not only the Ten Commandments. In our worldly and the spiritual living, the role clarity is something like a mirror. And this man was shown a mirror in front of him, that the role clarity was given, so he was not able to accept, so he ran away from the presence of Lord Jesus Christ. So how many times in our lives, having the goal clarity in our minds, how many times in my life I have failed to have the role clarity fulfilled or clearly understood or followed to the perfection of 100%. This is a self-examination that each one of us have to make. So one of the most powerful character of the Bible, we see the Old Testament, is Abraham. Abraham was living a settled life when millions of people were nomads. When you see the development of civilization, people are big nomads in the beginning stage earlier, and gradually they began to have a settled life. But here we say Abraham was having a settled life in the city of Ur. He was childless. His wife Sarah was barren. And they became old. This man was 75 years. His wife was 65 years. And they had no way of having a child anymore. The Bible clearly says Sarah was barren. Now, one fine moment, we see God speaks to him. Abraham Abraham and Sarai must have been a zealous people, even though they may not be fruitful in the worldly life as having a father or a mother or being called as a father and mother. They must have been a people of zeal. So God has chosen Abraham. Now history and archaeology may give us a different picture. I don't want to go into that now. And here we see Abraham was called by Lord and he speaks to him and God sets goals before Abraham. He was aimless. When there is no child, he may be a rich man, or he may be a powerful man, and when there is no posterity, there is no descendant, or there is no child, all his prosperity and the wealth are simply vain and waste. So this man did not have any goals. What is there for me? I have a lot of things to enjoy, but I have no children. So this man did not have any goal at all. He wants to just live the life and to put an end to his life when the time comes or when God calls. A man was living without any goal. Now God calls him and says, Abraham, I am going to set goals for you. So God set goals in front of Abraham at the age of 75 when he thought he is useless. He is fruitless. He is hopeless. And now God set goals before Abraham. I think all of us know this. If you read about this in Genesis 12 and 13, there are goals set. The first and the second verse of the 12th chapter says, Abraham needed to be a blessing. The first goal was something very interesting. He needed to be a blessing. The second one, he must become a father of great nation. We read about this in the first and second verses. In the Genesis 13 chapter 17th verse, we see he had to fix a territory for his descendants. How long the land may be, how vast the area may be, whatever you tramp on your feet will be given to your posterity, to the descendants. So now these are the three important goals set before Abraham. You must be a blessing. You must be a father of nation or father of a great nation. And you have to find or fix a vast territory as a nomad for your posterity or your descendants. Now, the man who has lost all the hopes, and God said, you are going to be a father of nations, a little hope began to grow. I'm going to be father of nations. How come? My wife is barren. I am 75 years. She is 65 years. How come I can become a father of nation? Now, God says, so let me accept the call. Let me set these goals before me as they are given by God. So he has got a goal clarity. So he immediately leaves the people. He leaves all the household. That's the role now. God says, if you want to reach the goal, you have to leave your people, leave your household, and leave a place and go to the land that God will show, or I will show you now from nomadic, settled life to nomadic life. Now this interesting role is being set before Abraham to reach the goal. Now Abraham has accepted these two. That is, now he was clear about his goal and the role, the goal clarity and the role clarity. So he was very much encouraged, strengthened, and he was assured, as I am going to be a blessing. It is a God-given goal, provided I leave my people, my role. Provided I leave my household, my role. Provided I leave my place, a role. God is going to make me a father of nation. So it is going to be my goal. So once again, all the three roles I have to play. So he was very much sure about the goal clarity and role clarity. So leaving everything, now he began to move from the settled life to nomadic life. That's fine. The seed of faith is being sprouted. His hope began to work out. man at the age of 75, he started moving out, leaving all his belongings, all his relatives to an unknown place. Where he is going, how his life is going to be, who are the people he is going to meet with, he never thought of anything. He simply accepted, and with goal clarity and role clarity, he began to move. All right, that's fine. Once he began to move, the Bible says there was a famine, so he had to move to Egypt. The people moving to Egypt is something very interesting always, moving in and moving out of Egypt. Now, when he went to Egypt, the people of Egypt, the Egyptians had seen Sarai at the age of 65, and they began to admire the beauty of Sarah. Now, I'm not able to imagine. Now, I'm 68 years old now, but I don't know how handsome I look like, but all of you know I'm an old man. And here we see a woman of 65 years was spoken widely as the most beautiful woman, and the information reaches the Pharaoh, and now this man was scared now. See, the goal clarity and the role clarity about the roles and the goals set by God was very much clear. There's no doubt. Now, he has a role to play as a husband. Now, what was his role? What was his goal as a husband? A husband is supposed to stand with the wife, protect her, meet all her needs, safeguard her, and must keep her happy as an equal. Now, when he finds an adverse environment or an unpleasant situation, and he tells her, you please tell everybody that you are my sister. Because of your beauty, they should not kill me. A man who was called by God, who had a goal clarity and the role clarity, now has something different in his mind. You see, here comes a diversion from the role clarity, and he has a fear of life. Now, this is a very big threat to each one of us now, even now at the time of pandemic. Most of us, you can say all of us, we have fear of life. Maybe my life, or my family member's life, or my neighbor's life, or my people all around the world, there's a fear. His fear of life made him to shun away. He was distracted from the role clarity as a husband now. He says, you please tell, you are my sister. Maybe true, because those days the cousins were given in marriage. So in one way of livelihood or maybe relationship, she was a sister. It's not a lie. But on the other hand, now she is a wife that is a better and stronger bondage. Now he denies the partnership of Sarai. The role clarity is diminishing now. Now, of course, God intervenes, because he has made a covenant with Abraham. God wanted to fulfill what the promises he has given to Abraham. So God intervenes and something different happens. She is saved, he is saved. But the fear of life. But when we see with the case of Abimelech, after again another 20 years or 15 years, we read about this in Genesis 21. Abimelech, king of Gerar, he hears about the beauty of Sarah. And again, the same thing happens to Sarah and Abraham. And he says, no, here also, please say, please tell the people, you are my sister. See, in the beginning, when his faithful life was at the beginning, and he had played a role, he had played a role which was not acceptable socially and also spiritually. So the role clarity was not so good. And after being experiencing God's love, God's protection, God's care everywhere for almost 15 years, again, he commits the same mistake. The role clarity is being shaken now. So he was not able to play the role of the husband with a clear idea. So his role clarity as a husband with Sarah is an utter failure. Not only with Sarah. God said, you are going to be the father of nations. And as he was getting old, he speaks to Lord, Lord, what are you going to give me? I am childless. Now he proposes something to God. This young man, Eliezer of Damascus, who is born and a chief in my family and he's a chief steward, I am going to adopt him as my son. God said, no, nothing doing. He's going to be your own son. See, the role clarity is being occasionally seen in Abraham's life as not a perfect one. So as soon as this Lord said, it is not Eliezer, it is going to be your own son, the information is being passed on to Sarah. Now Sarah suggests Hagar. Okay, now she becomes a concubine of Abraham. Lo and behold, she gets conceived. When she is conceived, the servant maid began to overpower the mistress. She neglects the responsibilities. She wants to show that she is somebody more important to Abraham than Sarah, because she is carrying the child of Abraham. Sarah was not happy about it. Now Sarah complains about this to Abraham, and Abraham says, no, she's in her hand. See, when Sarah asked him to take wholeheartedly, happily, this man entered with her in a relationship. And now she is conceived. And she was not bold enough to stand to say, it is you who has committed this. On the instruction of Lord, that my seed is going to be the father of this, a great nation. So you have done it. And he is not able to stand for Gahar. And we see, and he simply passes on the buck into the hands of the Sarah. See, as a husband, no role clarity with Sarai. Now, as a husband to Hagar, I can say, no role clarity. Fear of life made him, with a bewildered or confused mind, the role clarity was shaken. And here, we don't know whether he had a fear for Sarai, or whether he wanted to uphold Sarai in everything, because she has come with Abraham all the way for somewhere around 15 years from Ur. So we don't know. But here we see again, Hagar was forsaken. His role as a husband is not clear. He was not clear with the role as a husband. So the goal clarity is there, but the role clarity was shaken in every now and then. Even with the case of having a child to become a father of nations. So he proposes Eliezer. God said no. So Sarah proposes Hagar. He said yes. The child was born. Here also we see it was not God's plan. God has given the family a goal. A goal is to have Sarah a son through Abraham, that they both become the father and mother of nations. It is something very interesting. He loses the role clarity. But at the end, something different. The fear of life is something very interesting. As we are reeling under the pandemic throughout the world, now in India, it is something no words say, express. The situation is very much pathetic. The people blame the government blame the people. Whose goal and whose role is more important? The fear of life causes a lot of confusion. We always deviate from the goal clarity and role clarity. Now there is a powerful man, another character in the Bible, about whom we read in 1 Kings 17 chapter. I think immediately you can say it is Elijah. A powerful man was chosen to do a powerful work for the Lord. He prayed and there was no rain for 3.5 years. He made a very short and sweet and meaningful, powerful prayer, and immediately it began to rain. The king Ahab was searching for him everywhere. Queen Jezebel was searching for everywhere. But he was not seen by any one of them because God has taken him to a faraway place. And this man, after being revealed as a powerful prophet after 3.5 years, when he prayed, rained. And Bible says almost 840 worshippers of Baal were massacred there. Was so powerful, so successful. And he was able to show the people of Israel that the Lord God Yahweh is the real creator, the only living God who has created and chosen the people of Israel to be his children. He has proved. The people were all having or undergoing a role clarity now. From the worshipping of Baal, people realized the situation and they got the goal clarity, and people began to worship the Creator Lord with the role clarity. But now there is a message sent to Elijah from Queen Jezebel. Tomorrow by this time, I will revenge your life as you have done to the prophets of Baal. Just one statement. And this man, a powerful man, a man who was chosen by God to go to heaven without seeing death, he runs away. 1 Kings 19 chapter. Elijah was afraid and ran for his life. First verse. He sat under a tree, a broom tree, and prayed. And what is his prayer? On the fourth verse, take my life, I am no better than my ancestors. Take my life. See, God has a goal for Elijah that he must be taken to heaven without seeing death. See, God's goal set for Elijah was something different. And Elijah was not aware of the goal, so goal clarity was not there. And a man who had undergone a fear of life or who was afraid of Jezebel, he prayed to God, I am not a good person. In no way I'm a better person. Of course, he humbles. Now, what was his role? To prove the people of Israel, to appoint kings, that the mighty Lord, the Creator Lord, is the God of Israel. There is no one, not the created beings. It's not Baal. And this man, he, with a fear of life, lost his role clarity and he ran for life. The Bible says he walked for almost 3.5 days. Three days. He went and sat under a tree and prayed to God to take his life. What is goal clarity and role clarity? God never told Elijah, I'm not going to take you alive to heaven. But he was assigned with the responsibility to overthrow the rule or reign of Jezebel and Ahab and to appoint Jehu as a ruler. And he was there to judge the people and leading the people towards God. That was the goal assigned to him. The goal clarity was shattered. As a result, his role clarity was also shattered. Or maybe his role clarity was shattered. As a result, his goal clarity also was shattered. Another interesting character. I really wonder. The book is named on her name. Esther. Whenever I go through the book or read the book or study the book, I don't know why they have named the book as Esther, because he's a very, very insignificant character of the Bible, of the book. And this book speaks of two very, very important, two poles, two powerful people, two powerful men. Maybe a hero, not a villain, but an anti-hero, I call him. Mordecai and Amon. See, both of the people had goals. Mordecai had a goal. He was very much clear. He had a goal clarity, absolutely. Haman also had a goal clarity. He wanted to be the next person of the king, to the king. He was working systematically, very seriously, with his friends, with his wife, with his family members, that he should be the most powerful person in the country or maybe in the nation. And Mordecai, he wanted to play a very important role with a goal clarity that Jews must be restored. So he was so sincere and loyal to the king and to the tribe that he belongs to. And when he looked at Haman, he was so strong with his convictions, with his goal clarity, that he wanted to save God and elevate his own people and put down the strange people called Jews. We interestingly read the Bible, read the book of Esther. The role of Esther is something very insignificant. Why is it insignificant? She does not know why she has gone to the palace. She did not know how the king Ahasuerus chose her to be the best one. Mordecai brought her up. She went for the interview. She was selected and she was taken to the palace. She, without having any goal, without having any goal clarity and also the role clarity, she was there in the palace, like most of us attend the churches. We, most of us, are just like Esther. No goal clarity, no role clarity, but I am here in the church because I am accustomed to, I am used to. She was enjoying life, enjoying the life of a queen there. Now the trouble comes. Haman has planned systematically, stealthily, that the Jews are eradicated or eliminated from the kingdom of Ahasuerus. Now, Mordecai sends a word to Esther. You go to the king, speak to him, tell your problems. And what was the response? No goal, no role. Now, Mordecai, who had a goal clarity, and he plays his role very, very vibrantly and visibly, and he says, if you remain silent at this time, Esther 4 chapter verses 12 to 15, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place. But you and your father's family will perish. And who knows but that you have come to royal position for such a time as this. Now, Mordecai makes Esther realize the goal. Help her have a goal clarity. Who knows? God has brought you to the royal position for such a time like this, as this. Till then, Esther did not have any goals. She had not had any goal clarity, so she was not playing any role, so no role clarity. Now, a trouble came. An unexpected and not anticipated problem came. The fear of life came for the whole tribe of Jews, or maybe the religious group. That's not the tribe of Jews. All right? Now, then under pressure, she says, okay, all fast for 3 days. Now you have set me a goal. I should go to the king and plead for. My goal is clear now. I have got the goal clarity. But when she accepts the goal clarity, when she has got the goal clarity, she says, I will go to the king on the verse 16. First chapter 16th verse. I'll go to the king even though it is against the law. I think all of you know the story. And she says, and if I perish, I perish. See, God has chosen a young, beautiful girl from the lower strata of the society, from the insignificant part of the country, and brought her to the palace of the emperor. Was not having any goal, so no role. Now, when the goal's clarity was there with Esther, Still, she was not convinced of the role clarity. God has brought me to the palace, to the royal palace, that I will be able to play a key role in saving the Jews. Now, wholeheartedly, no, half-heartedly, with faithlessness, with unbelief, she goes to the king saying, even if I perish, I perish. How do we meet the challenges in our life? Are you like Esther, who was not having a goal clarity and a role clarity? And after having the goal being enlightened, our goal clarity is known. Are we playing the role with clarity? It is a very big challenge. So fear and disbelief or unbelief, faithlessness make us go away from God. So as a result, we lose our goal clarity and our life is without role clarity. But there is one man in the Bible who stands outstanding when it comes to role clarity and goal clarity. No doubt, a man called Saul. I think all of us know how he was called, how he was taken up to ministry. And Paul had a different goal. When he entered Damascus, he had a different goal. He wanted to persecute the Christians as a Pharisee, as a member of the Sanhedrin, as a scholar of law, as a member of Jewish religion. He wanted to persecute the Christian with an official order. He enters into Damascus. He had a goal clarity, absolutely. And he was also fulfilling his role with role clarity. Till he meets the Lord, or Lord meets him at the gates of Damascus. Now, God sets goals before him. Now, Paul's goals were totally eliminated from the picture. God sets goal for Paul. He says to Ananias, Acts 9 chapter verses 15 and 16 to Ananias, "This man is my chosen instrument to carry my name before the Gentiles and their kings, before the people of Israel, and I'll show him how much he must suffer for my name." Now, goal is set by God. Even Saul did not know that. The goal that was set for Paul were informed or passed on to Ananias. Ananias was suspicious about Saul, so he did want to accept the call for him to go and meet Saul. Now God tells him the goal that is going to be set for Saul, that he makes him Paul. This man, after meeting Jesus Christ, that's a wonderful, miraculous meeting. I don't know. We people do not have such experiences. A light that is brighter than the mid-sun shone around him. Jesus spoke to him. And his goals were changed. Whom he wanted to kill, he became one among them. Whom he denied as the Lord, he began to preach that he is the Lord and the Christ. A man who wanted to persecute people, he submitted himself to be persecuted. Now, there was a goal clarity, and we see his role clarity is also very much matching 100% in his ministry. If you want to read his role clarity, fulfilling the goal clarity, you can initially read from 2 Corinthians 11 chapter verses 21 to 29. He speaks about all the difficulties, all the horrible incidents that he has undergone, the dangers and harms, where he was able to stand all these persecutions, all the difficulties, all the dangers, and to stand as a witness for God and Lord Jesus Christ, preaching Lord Jesus is Christ. Now, many of us do not know why they preach Lord Jesus is Christ. That's another sermon. Jesus is Christ was a message preached by the disciples. Jesus is Christ was a message preached by St. Paul. But we do not know why Jesus, what Christ, and why they have to preach Jesus is Christ. Now, that's not a main idea of the sermon here. Now, this man, having a goal clarity while entering Damascus, doing his best with a zeal, with a role clarity as he entered Damascus, has undergone a right about an experience, and with goal clarity and role clarity, he further continues and he says, therefore, I do not run like a man running aimlessly. See, can I say boldly, I do not run like a man running aimlessly. I do not fight like a man beating in the air. As a member of the church, the remnant, as a believer of Lord's truth in the last days, as we are chosen by God to stand as testimonies and witnesses for the Lord, are we able to say that we are running our life with an aim? We are running a life with an aim. We are fighting a life with an aim or a goal. Can we boastfully say, I do not run like a man running aimlessly. I do not fight like a man beating in the air. Now, it's a question of self-examination this Sabbath afternoon to each one of us. The day I expected Lord Jesus Christ, just not because I am born in the Samadhi family, no. Not just because I was dedicated by the grandparents of the church, no. It is not just because I was brought up in an Adventist family. No, I am not an Adventist, just because I was brought up in an Adventist family. It is not just because I studied in the Seventh-day Adventist schools and colleges. I learned theology. No, I am not a Seventh-day Adventist. I am not a Christian. Is it because I have served in the church for 40 years? No, still I am not a Seventh-day Adventist or a Christian. Unless until I have accepted Lord Jesus Christ with a goal clarity and role clarity as Paul, I am not a Christian at all. If there is a stigma or confusion in my goal clarity, or if I'm not having a role clarity, I am not a Christian at all. Still, we will be people beating around in the air. I am a Christian when Jesus Christ is born in me, not just because I was born in Adventist family. It may be the same case with many of you. Not just because I am a theologian, I am a student of theology, I cannot say I am a Christian. Jesus Christ must be born in me. I must have committed myself with the goal clarity and the role clarity that I can be certified by my Lord as a good servant. But most of us, as Paul admonishes to the church of Galatia, Galatians 3rd chapter, verses 3 and 4. Are you so foolish? After beginning with the Spirit, are you now trying to attain your goal by human effort? What a great question it is. When I accepted my Lord Jesus Christ, with all humility, with all humbleness, with all broken heart, realizing that I am a sinner, I prayed to the Lord, oh Lord, forgive me all my sins against you and my neighbors. Please accept me as a child. With a broken heart, I went to the cross. With a broken heart, I met the Lord Jesus Christ who was nailed on the cross. With a broken heart, with a humility, I submitted myself under the foot of the cross to be cleansed. I started my spiritual life with the Spirit that I will have my goal clarity experience with role clarity. That is the Spirit. It is not the Holy Spirit here. The Spirit is, as mentioned in Galatians, is the goal clarity and the role clarity being united together, are culminated together, are brought up together, are grown together. Are you so foolish? After beginning with the Spirit, are you now trying to attain your goal by human? Can I attain my salvation through my human effort? No, I cannot show myself as a righteous person in front of anybody, absolutely. My righteousness is a filthy rag in the presence of the sight of God. He says beautifully, for I am already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time has come for me to departure. Maybe at the end point, and God has shown him, okay, my son, your role is over. You have attained the goal clarity. Your role clarity was so clear. Your role here in this earth is over. Just before he could drink the offering, he could be put an end, or his life is put an end, or before his departure, he says, he beautifully says, I have fought a good fight. I finished my race. I have kept my faith. A role clarity. I have fought a good fight. Good fight. Role clarity. I finished my race. Role clarity. I kept my faith. Role clarity. Now my goal clarity is, now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness. My goal is the crown of righteousness. My dear fellow believers in Christ, the members of the last days church, let us remember we are here in the church with a goal, that is to have the crown of righteousness, to have eternal life, to be with the Lord Jesus Christ and God the Father forever and ever with joy. To not to see more, any more death, no more pain, no more cries, no more tears. That is supposed to be our goal. Are we here in the church for any other purpose? A few are very interesting characters in the church. There are believers who are a program Adventist. They are only for the church programs. Church programs. And there are people, they are the church for the positions. There are some people, they are for projects. As an administrator, I have seen that projects. I am in the church for projects. I am not here for programs. I am not for position, but I am for the projects. But are we for a principled, practical Christianity in our lives? Is my goal, if it is with the clarity, my life is supposed to be exhibiting the love of Lord with role clarity every time. We should say, or we should be able to say, with a role clarity, I am fighting a good fight. I am going to finish my race with a role clarity. And we should be able to say, with a role clarity, I have kept my faith, so that I will have the crown of righteousness, because my mind or my knowledge, my wisdom is very much clear with a goal clarity that the crown of righteousness is waiting for me. My dear fellow brethren, in our every walk of life, do we have the goal clarity and role clarity? They go hand in hand. Many times I realize I have my goal clarity, but I fail only in my role clarity. I do commit sin. I do transgress the law. I do go against my neighbors because I break, or I am confused and I am bewildered with my low role clarity. So once I am very much established with role clarity, even under any situation, my goal clarity and role clarity will go hand in hand. Now we have a goal to reach. The goal is nothing but the crown of righteousness which God is giving, waiting for us, with which what God is waiting for us. He is going to give us. He is waiting to give us the crown of righteousness. Am I playing a role with a clarity, a clear clarity to attain this? If there is a doubt, there is fear of life, there is disbelief, certainly I am not going to have the crown of righteousness. Now in this very pathetic, very dangerous, alarming situation, are we established with the goal clarity, that we are able to play the role clarity? how do I stand as a testimony for Lord Jesus Christ with all difficulties? Jesus has given a very, very important warning in John 14 chapter and the verse 1. Let not your heart be troubled. The role clarity is something very interesting. My heart should not be troubled. 1,000 may fall at my right. 10,000 may fall at my left. I may have to walk over the corpse. I may have to undergo the valley of death. But my role clarity is that I will not be troubled. I cannot be shaken. I cannot be moved because I have a strong goal clarity, that is the crown of righteousness is waiting for me. Are we running the race with aim, or are we running the race aimlessly? Are we fighting the fight, a meaningful fight with my own enemy who is within me? The law of sin? Or am I pretending to be a person who is fighting against sin in my life? Goal clarity and role clarity. Not only in spiritual life, the worldly part also, it can be implied. It's my prayer, my dear children, my dear brother, believers in Christ. Each one of us have got goal clarity. There's no doubt about it. The role clarity is very simple. My goal is to move forward towards the cross on which Jesus was nailed for me, to give me or to provide me salvation. I look at the cross. My sight is not being deviated left or right, back or front, without any trouble, without any being shaken, without being moved. I look at the cross where in which my Lord has shed the precious blood for me to be saved. I move forward at any allowing situation. A goal clarity can be realized with a role clarity. It is my prayer. The mighty Lord, through his truth, through his words, through his promises, strengthen us with a role clarity that each one of us will have the crown of righteousness when the Lord comes for the second time. I pray that each one of us are blessed to have such a blessed, blissful experience to live forever and ever with the Lord in heaven. In Jesus' name, I pray. God bless you all. Thank you.
Amen. We will now have the closing song, which is hymn number 625, Higher Ground.
I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day, still praying as I onward bound, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground, Lord, lift me up and I shall stand by faith on heaven's stable land. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. My heart has no desire to stay where doubts arise and fears dismay. Though some may dwell where these abound, my prayer, my aim is higher ground. Lord, lift me up and I shall stand by faith on heaven's stable land. A higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to live above the world. Though Satan's doubts at me are hurled, for faith has called the joyful sound, the song of saints on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and I shall stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher place than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to scale the utmost height and catch a gleam of glory bright. But still I'll pray till heaven I've found. Lord, lead me on to higher ground. Lord, lift me up and I shall stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and I shall stand by faith on heaven's stable land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground.
Shall I pray?
Yes, please.
Let's pray. Our dear and loving Father in heaven, our mighty Lord, what a great privilege it is for us to worship in your presence on the holy day. Dear Lord, thou hast been so good to us in the past. You have called each one of us by our name and made us a sheep of your flock. We submit ourselves unto your care and keeping, O Lord. We simple and humble people pray that we are able to have our goal clarity and role clarity in our spiritual life. Dear Lord, bless all the ones, those who have been listening to the message and bowing their heads in your presence. Be close to them, O Lord. Care for them with all their spiritual needs met with. We know the harms and dangers of the world that is being existing at present, O Lord. If it is thy will, keep us without being affected or afflicted, having a heart that is not being troubled or shaken. Let all of us have the faith being rooted in the love of the Lord Jesus Christ, who has died for us on the Calvary. Cleanse us, O Lord. Strengthen us that we are able to run our life with aim, with role clarity, that we are able to have the crown of righteousness with a goal clarity. We cannot do it ourselves, O Lord. Only with thy help, with your words, with your promises, we will be able to run the race. Strengthen us, O Lord, once again. Be close to us and lead us till the Son of Lord appears the clouds of heaven, that we are able to have a place in the kingdom of God. Bless the church, bless the congregation, bless the pastor, and all the ones, those who are sick and need the help of the Lord to be cured, to be healed, and the ones, those who are discouraged and dismayed due to the sad demise of their beloved family members. Strengthen us, O Lord, so that all of us will be able to be thy children with a power from above to run the life with aim, with role clarity and goal clarity, reach heaven. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. We very much appreciate your message to us today, Dr. Samuel. The fact that we are not to run this race aimlessly, but we strive towards that mark, as Paul said, to obtain that crown and to obtain eternal life. So thank you for your encouraging words today. And we pray that the Lord will continue to bless you. I know Pastor Daniel would have loved to be here, but he's probably told you he's at a gathering where they